After the long discussion on the gear required for macro photography, I will just demonstrate some desktop shots in this one, which would allow us to build up more for the future videos. So let's take a look at my desktop that I use generally for the macro desktop photography. I only need a very small space around 6x6, that is more than enough for reasonable close-ups and actual true macro shots. I got this small acrylic sheet just before the lockdown. It is a good replacement for not cleaning my desktop and just cleaning up the acrylic sheet. I am going to use a Nikon D850 with a Tamron 90mm macro lens for this demonstration, along with my Godox flash on a cord as explained in the previous video. For this video, we will see how to get objects with a black background. But first, a brief explanation as to how we get the black background. The first thing to understand is that light from a flash can only be controlled by the aperture and not the shutter speed. The flash in general is way too fast for the shutter speeds on most cameras, and only aperture can control the amount of light we get from there. The second thing to know is that light falls off or dims as the distance from the light source increases. This follows what is commonly known as the inverse square law. In simple terms, the light will get weaker with distance. Based on the above points, if we have an aperture value that is high enough, let us say f18 or f22, for example, it will cut out all the ambient light in my room, and therefore anything that is lighted by the flash is the only thing that will show up in the camera image frame. What follows is, if we use a flash to light a subject and make sure the flash power and direction is just good enough to light the subject, then we will get a black background. A basic understanding of the depth of field would be very helpful. In general, the larger the distance of the camera to the subject, the larger is the area that appears to be in focus. A good site to get a general idea on how this works is given in the description. For macros and close-ups, the depth of field is very, very small, and it becomes critical to have the focus point exactly where we want it. Another critical term to understand is the flash sync speed. A link to Wikipedia is given in the description below. This is essentially the highest shutter speed that you can use when using a flash. There are ways of using a higher shutter speed, but we are not going to get into that for macros. We will discuss all of this in more detail in future videos. For now, let's just look at the settings I'm going to use for these demonstration desktop shots and a brief look at how to improve them in post using Lightroom or any equivalent application. So I have my shutter speed set to 250th of a second, which is the flash sync speed for the Nikon D850. The aperture is set to f22 and ISO 200. Generally, this would be the base ISO, which is 64 for the D850, but I'll go with 100 for now. The focus is set to a single point and multiple continuous shots. Ideally, it would be single point, single shot, but we'll discuss this more in detail later. For now, it really does not matter. My flash is set to manual mode at 1/16th power and a zoom of 50mm. Yes, I already mentioned that I'm using a 90mm macro lens, but we will get into all those details one by one later. One word of caution before we start, and you will see this in the images that we look at later. When shooting desktop macros, make sure the object is clean. Otherwise, the shot will show up all the dust and stuff on it. If possible, wash with soap and water first. And let's get to what I have picked up for today. I have these five objects that we will shoot and see how changing the angle and the distance of the flash changes the image. Keep in mind, if I move the flash further away from the subject, it will get dimmer. The closer I move the flash to the subject, it will get brighter.
The sanitizer bottle. Note how I have the flash directed right on top of it, so we don't have any light going beyond it, and the aperture will cut all the ambient light behind it and give us a totally black background, which is what we were looking for. Yes, it is as simple as that. Now let's take a look at what other angles of the flash do to the image. We will look at all these images in Lightroom once we are done with the shots. So once we are done with the sanitizer, we will pick up the other objects one by one in order of their size. I am going to speed up these clips so we don't have to wait for all the shots, and then we will go directly to Lightroom and take a look at the actual shots of all these five objects one by one. Note the flash distance and angle in the shots, and then we will look at all these in Lightroom. Keep in mind, the closer the flash, the brighter the subject. The moment you move the flash away, it will become dimmer and will have lesser reflections. Now let's look at all these shots in Lightroom. This is of course what I had taken to show the flash settings. These are from my 7500, the acrylic sheet, the workspace. Let's go into develop mode so we have a better render. So this is more like white, and generally what we would do is pick up the white balance tool and just click here to correct the white balance. This is a shot of my workspace. Now here, since we have all these lines, I have gone into the transform section and selected auto. So it straightens up everything here. And of course, I have done the same, the white balance. I have a YouTube video running. And this is all the space I actually require, and I have got this acrylic sheet here. Okay, let's move on to the next one. This is the object shot, again from the 7500. These are the objects that we've shot in this session. Another shot of the acrylic sheet. Now if you use the normal pop-up flash, which I have on the 7500, or a camera mounted flash, the light will go into the opposite direction, that is the background of the subject, and everything will get lighted up. Now this was in TTL mode, just to demonstrate why we use manual to control the light. This is what you would get with a pop-up flash, or if the flash is mounted on the camera. Now, this is the shot we took with the external flash. As you can see, the acrylic sheet is not very clean, and we have all these spots very visible, which is why I recommended we clean out the sheet and the subject. Even on the subject, if you notice, of course the scratches will not go away with washing, but the dust would. I also have the videos in here which we saw. If I bring the flash closer, this is what happens. Of course, we can bring the highlights down, we can bring the exposure down. The thing to remember when we are using an external flash, most of your image will come in the highlights area. In general, you can bring the shadows down completely. Not always, but in general, you can bring the shadows down because your subject will always be in the highlights area. We can bring up some shadows here, but if we bring out all the shadows, note how the background also starts coming out, and that is not very desirable. This is the next. This is when we took the flash to one side. You can see this side is lighted up a lot more. These are the videos, and then we went on to the batteries. This is one shot, this is another. Notice how the back of the subject remains black because we are not pointing the flash in the normal direction one would expect. It is coming from the side or the top or the bottom, and therefore no flash light is going beyond the subject, and therefore the background remains black. Now this is the kind of barcode we had on that plastic sheet. We just bring the shadows down and we have black again. This is the video. Now these are the chickpeas. Note the details, and that's one of the beauties of doing macro photography. You will notice details in the smallest of things, household items that you would have never seen before. The focus point obviously is essential, as you can see. And look at this one, this is totally out. Why? Because the camera was somewhere here instead of being parallel. Had it been parallel, we would have gotten this entire area in focus. And we'll get to those details later. Now here I got the flash even closer and pulled the camera back. See, this is almost totally gone, but let's pull down the exposure and the highlights and some of the shadows, and it doesn't work. So it was just too powerful, the flash in this case. So I moved the flash a bit back, and we can bring back some of the highlights, increase the whites, and of course, for some strange reason, the white balance will almost always be off. You'll have to fix it. And of course, then we can crop. If we want the reflection, we keep it, otherwise we can simply mask it off. Then we come to the cotton bud. Just try and reduce the highlights, but this part is blown out because the flash was just too powerful for this. The other reason is because I was using a ISO 100 on the 850, whereas my settings were for a base ISO, which would have been 100 in case of the 7500. So I moved the flash out a bit, and we start getting far more details. You can play with the shadows. Note how the dust particles actually become part of a bokeh. And I moved it further away here, so we get an even darker one. We can even play with the shadows in this kind of case. This is normal lighting, just on top and side. Is the video. Now this is with a pop-up flash with the 7500, and this is a lot better because I simply blocked the pop-up flash with a piece of paper. And this is the kind of regular sheets that you get, or even an A4 size sheet. You can just use it to bounce light for reflective subjects, like in this case, or use it as a diffuser, like in this case, just putting a sheet here and bouncing light off it can totally change the mood. Now in this case, I've put the sheet on top and the flash is coming from over it, so the subject is protected almost entirely by this sheet, and you can see the difference. Same here, so we'll just copy the previous settings. Note how we have these kind of distractions, but that is not an issue, and we will get into these kind of processes later as and when we move more into details about shooting macros. We can also wipe all of this out. You just need to be careful that the subject remains in the clear and the rest can be dealt with in post. Have fun till the next one.